Many a sin I have witnessed, and in many indeed I have been. Many a rat I've befriended, and so many a thorn stood between. But of all of the demons I've known, none could compare to you.
Oops. Let's see if my mic works now. Hello? Okay, that seems to be working. Okay, I think I'm gonna kill the lights here a bit. There we go. So if anyone has any problems with the sound, just let me know. So I've been meaning to do this for quite a while actually, but there's always been reasons that I've been pulling it off. But I've decided to have this stream to make a show of some of the work that has gone into Doombringer during the last year or so, since the last proper update was about exactly a year ago. So I'm gonna start the game up and we'll take a look what we find. Let's see here. So I'm using a quite different build of Dark Places now. Game has been updated quite, the engine has been updated quite substantially during the last year, so it's not using OpenGL2 anymore. It's actually OpenGL3, which has had a bit of some benefits and a lot of bugs that has been worked on during the year, but also meant that I had to rework some things with the game as well. So for instance, a command like rShowSurfaces3 no longer actually works. I just realized that I must have done that on a laptop. So the things that has been worked on, let's start with the easy ones to look at, has been the ability to save and load games in the menu, which is a big deal for someone who's not the greatest programmer. And I see that most of the servers are crashed, so I'm gonna have to restart those later. The options menu has had a lot of work on it. You now can actually select country and player models within the menu. There's a lot of new models coming in the new version as well, which we, yeah, you can't really see them because I haven't made thumbnails for them yet, but we'll see them when we play some single player. Anyway, so this was something I was quite happy with, actually. Made a bit of a campaign system, so anyone who makes a new map or a campaign, they can just drop the files and you can get the set up a bit of a campaign in the, so it comes up in the menu. You don't have to run it as long as you add it into the base folder. You can actually have it show up here with a bit of a backstory and stuff like that. So, and it can be basically as long as you want it to be. You can also have a bit of a piece of artwork. I'll probably add to it as more and more as time goes by, but this is what I got right now. It's just a lump in a folder. So I'm going to select the Grindhouse of Todelmer, which is a map episode I've been working on, but I'm starting to become more and more unhappy with it as I go along, but I think it works as a starting point where I can just test things like enemies and textures, and so it's a bit of a mess to look at, but at least it's letting me work with the actual maps rather than just in a test map. So we'll start with that, and then we'll look at some of the other things like animations and stuff. So this guy was standing behind the barrels and basically killed himself because he shot them. This map is supposed to be a bit of an introduction map, which it's going to be very simple. It's just your first dipping your toes into getting acquainted with a few things like key doors, stuff like that. So actually I haven't added a key to this door in this area yet, so I have to cheat my way through. But before I can do that, I have to actually activate the cheats. Can I just remember? I'm not sure if I can even get keys. Let's just get through this. Okay, never mind. Let's do this. Map Grindhouse 2. So, because there's really not much more to see there, I just want the first room to be with us here. So this map will lead into this map, which is the one I originally intended to be the one map to accompany this version coming out. But oh yeah, I need to turn off the real-time lighting effects, otherwise rendering will be troublesome for my computer. Actually ordered new computer parts today, so have a bit faster processor and stuff like that, or a lot faster. So this used to be really hard, and now it's been rebalanced to be a lot easier. And this shotgun is just placeholder materials cobbled together by the bolter and the shotgun models. Oh, I'm going to die. So pretty casual settings as well with hit shakes and stuff like that. There we go. I survived. Also made it so the hit beeps actually don't play in single player. You can still turn them on, but you have to manually activate them for that. Because, in my opinion, they didn't quite work. Well, they were just too aggressive for single player. Works great in multiplayer, but yeah, they just became overbearing to me. But since not everyone will feel that, I made sure to allow people to turn them on. But I didn't want to keep turning them on and off for my own. So, oh, crap. So yeah. That's one change. Also, a lot of things like being able to turn off fog is something I've added. A lot of small things like that. Rather more significant change to the weapons actually is that I decided to make the rocket launcher and grenade launcher significantly more powerful in single player, actually twice as powerful than in the multiplayer, because they didn't really, while it works really well to have them like doing 100 damage from a direct hit in multiplayer, in single player doesn't actually work that well, because the rocket becomes pretty anemic and then. So if I, for instance, get this rocket launcher here, I will be able to jib these really low level enemies quite a lot easier. And I actually also have a wider spread. They don't make you bounce further though, so it also helps making players less prone to rocket jumping in single player, similar to in Quake 1, for instance. Because, yeah. One of those things are problematic from a single player perspective unless you want to drastically change the way single player is played. I wasn't really prepared to do that. So this map is pretty dark, which is actually because I had been making all these really bright multiplayer maps. I wanted to make something a bit more dark and grungy. Play a bit more with light effects, which I haven't really had time to do yet, but I wanted, this room is pretty processor intensive because of all the rotating stuff. So you see the frame rate dropping a bit there. I need to work on that. I had to redo the elevator code as well, so because the coding for the elevators in Quake 1 was problematic from making something like this. They were just platforms moving up and down, and yeah, that generally. I wanted something more similar to a lift, like in a that you can send up and down rather than just press and have it activate when you moved on to it. More like in Doom, basically. So you're not actually supposed to have this weapon here, of course, but since I sucked so bad, I had to even the odds a bit. You're quite squishy as well, so you have to be quite, you know, pretty careful, or you will get eaten up. At least before you get the red armor. Can't really take many of those bullets before you die. There we go. And here you can see the stat bar I made for a single player, as well as this isn't, you're not supposed to be able to remove this around when I'm done with it, but added a bit of a map here. Okay, that doesn't show showing in this one because the map is so large, becomes almost invisible. But you can have item, you have you can have maps where you get a challenge to find all the items, for instance, and stuff. Sort of like a collectathon principle, though you don't really win anything by it. But you can use it to guide the player. Tell them, okay, you missed a lot of the map. Not just using just marked secrets. So this map is not actually supposed to come after here. This was the first single player map I did any significant work on. So. Oh yeah, Freddian. That's probably true. But the good part about the rockets and grenades not bouncing around more is that, or rather, keeping it simple. But you know, you can only do so many rocket jumps now before you get eaten alive, basically. So, oh yeah, lightning gun. Picked up here. I fixed so the lightning gun now. It's not perfect yet. There are still times when it kind of messes up a bit. But what people have asked for is a lightning gun that does not lag behind your viewpoint. And also, let's see here, view HUD. If you move your the lightning gun beam will always eject from the barrel of the gun. Oh my god, I'm deformed. So that's pretty nice. Won't no longer spawn in middle of the nowhere, which is. Was quite an accomplishment for me. I wasn't sure I was gonna be able to fix it. Well, this is one of them. I still have a lot of rigging to do because you see they're tearing quite a lot in there. But these are the new enemy models, and this is a new player model. I have a few other enemy models already modeled, but I haven't rigged them up yet and stuff like that, because I Need to add more detail to the height poly model before I bake the details. Also, you notice it's very quiet in the game right now because none of the buttons or monsters actually have any sound. Which is a shame, but all in due time. So. Oops. I died. So I'm gonna take us to a map called Test Items. Show off some of them items. Our barrels. Power-ups. These are all the power-ups that the game has so far, which is the Berserk power-up. It has an explosive effect so it has a bit of an AoE effect when you punch your fists into something. Also it does damage to yourself, which is problematic, I suppose. Oh yeah, and also picked up a backpack of ammo there, so I can actually pick up twice as much ammo now. Anyway, and we have the quad damage, of course. Invulnerability. Vampiric damage. So if I, for instance... No, that was spread damage. So spread shots. Let's see. Get a 9, 6, 7. This is a chaos sphere, so it can shoot lots of rockets at once. More cartridges, rail guns, grenades, etc. Then you have this is just a so you don't take damage from. What's it called? Lava and stuff. And then you have the vampiric damage, which allows you to suck leech damage from other players. And right now it's super powerful. Okay, you can see the situation where the lightning gun bugs out a bit. I don't know why that is happening. For some reason, it really shouldn't happen. But I'll figure it out. So right now the vampiric damage is super overpowerful, but I haven't really had time to test it in any capacity, so I wanted to keep it like that. Because there's no limit how much you can leech from it, so you can actually go over 200 health with it. As well as it also leeches back 100% of the damage you do. But imagine a map with an amazing amount of monsters and you just leech damage from all of them like crazy. So, this is actually a mirror. I'm gonna have to turn on mirror effects, refraction. So, I've been doing quite a lot of work on the animation for the player, trying to make him a bit more. I don't know, lifelike, I suppose. Now I stopped doing working on the animations because actually I'm going to work with my sister, who's working in the motion capture industry at the company called Qualisys. So we are going to do some motion capture work for to get the as good animations as possible for this. Oh my god, they are all desynced, so this is a mess. Let's see if any of them are oh yeah, a ray gun. Okay, only slightly. So Ah, there we go. And a grenade launcher. So that was a lot of work I spent on that last summer to get that to work properly. Found a lot of fun bugs to do, figure out how to solve them. And another thing I wanted to show right now was the new simple item system. Because I moved all the... Okay, so I turn on the simple items and you notice the models are just acting strange. That is because the way the simple item system work now is that you have to update the models manually, basically, before they can get to the new model. So you have to get them out of your view frame and then they get updated again. The reason I could do this was because I moved all the model stuff of the and the visuals of the and of the items to client side. This means that if you record a demo with simple items, you don't actually have to have them on when you watch the demo back like you did before. Also means that all the models, all the simple items are actually models, and that means there's no blurry lines, blurry details, but also that I can have some animations and shaders in them to create some cool effects. So extremely sharp shader effects, even some let's see, there we go. So that's backpack. I added some a bit of reflection effects on them. You know, can notice that they move, so it's a bit of a parallaxing effect because I simply made them slightly three-dimensional. So all the weapons have this spinning gear, all the power-ups have this inverted gear, kind of. Health point, power-ups, boxes, armors. So, and keys, of course. There we go. What else? There's so many small things under the hood, basically, that I had to do. A lot of bug fixes that most people would never even notice. Like getting the right... if I kill someone with my left hand, it actually gives the correct hand message for, yeah, he killed you with your left hand, or with your right hand. Animations for the weapons have been redone, the whole animation system for the weapons have been redone. So instead of being one model, it's actually three models for each weapon. The hands are one model, then the weapon itself, and like with the barrel of this one, this gun, it's a third model. And I noticed that it's a bit too far, I need to align that better. There's also which allowed me to fix this. Now this is, I don't know why this is happening right now. Like I said, it's a bug I need to figure out. Yes, a lot of work has been put into getting textures in the maps. I bought actually a year subscription of CG textures to get basic generic textures like bricks and stuff like that for a very low effort, because making them yourself is an incredibly time consuming effort, so that was definitely worth it, which allowed me to make maps look like this map, Duel 9, which I'm sure some of you will recognize from last tournaments. So most of these textures, not the diffusion textures themselves, but the height and normal map textures are from CG textures resources. I'm looking forward to when I get to this point in making single player maps in this kind of world. Or when you all can play this in multiplayer on a tournament or something. But as you could tell with the animations on the player, it's still a bit off. Still got a bit ways off to deal with. So yeah. If anyone got any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. If not, then I think I'm actually working on some maps and maybe listen to some music. This map actually has... I've tried to make it as identical to what it was before as possible, but I've made a few changes to make it play a bit better. Like this step used to be that you could only reach it from this way, making it a bit sometimes a bit tricky to get onto. But also made this jump pad a bit more exact so you don't fly off into the stratosphere like you used to. Also, we have this jump pad here. Used to be very easy to get knocked down and then jump up again and not be able to get out. It's a lot easier to get out now. So if someone algae's here, you can just air strafe into safety. Well, moderate safety. Also, has been working with Greed on a map for movement, and how could I forgot? Map intro. This is not the map that we've been working on, but I have actually made a race mode. It's very simple, and I'm also going to show you a bug with my client side model thing, because those models I have not yet made actually travel with the lifts, so I need to fix that. So here starts a new race. It's very simple in this map so far. You just move over the start line to start a new race every time. Oh no, I get a bad time. So checkpoint. Checkpoint 2. Oh my god. And checkpoint 3. Oh no, I have to go back again. And finish line. 43 seconds. Yeah, that was a terrible time. But at least it's functional. It's nothing impressive, but it allows people to make race maps. I was considering making race lines through a lot of the maps, but haven't done that yet. So this is so far the only map with an actual race in it. But I've been working on this first set of maps, which is just this area so far, which is oops, fuck that up. Oh, come on. I'm embarrassing myself here. There we go. Playing around with the resources I made a bit. And now we come out into this area, which looks like shit. But eventually it's gonna look nice. And the mission here kind of is to finish the time map in as much faster time as possible and still get all the green items. To get a 100, 100, 100. Which is, I mean, finishing the map is going to be quite easy, but getting all the items with it is requiring a few jumps that you really have to. You're probably not gonna make the first time, unless you are someone who's actually good at movement, which I'm not. Come on! Oh, Jesus Christ, I'm such a mess. Anyway, so this has been a very shallow look at what I've been doing. Hopefully you can see where it's going, to a degree at least. Also quite happy with how this torch I made turn out. I like making torches and stuff like that. Hopefully also, as I've been asking around for people who might be interested in making maps. Ah, there we go. And here is basically going to be another cave where you move on to the next map. I don't want them to be too big, because I want it to be more like checkpoints for progression. Fun thing with the saving system is actually you can save multiplayer games as well. So if you have a player disconnect or something, like you have a crash, you can actually do a server save, and then just people join in the same order that they first joined, and you can actually resume the game from where you left off. I haven't figured out a way to allow players to do their own quick savings without haven't figured out a way to do it where you would possibly make the server it's potentially, I mean, being able to save the game too much would potentially crash the server. I've been thinking about a few things, like having the server save the game automatically every few seconds or something. The game release date, well, oops, timed out. The game is currently in open alpha, so you can actually download it from doombringer.eu, but I've contacted GOG about getting on their service, But haven't had any response from them yet. I'm probably gonna have to start a company just to get on Steam and GOG, so I just have to invest time learning about what that would require. Hey Nicky, that was a while ago since I saw you last. But yeah, so I'd really like to get it on Steam because of the whole availability thing and making updates easier to process with people, players, because having people go manually download updates and stuff like that is just not a great room. It's a great way to not have people update, basically. But also being able to announce events like EU Cups and stuff like that. Sure, it's going to be people are a lot less likely to try a game if it's not on Steam, as we all know. So yeah, definitely looking into it. It's quite easy to get on Steam, so it's just the matter of starting a company to be able to do the business aspect of being on Steam. So what is so Nicky is someone I used to play a lot of Quake Live with back in the day. Haven't seen him around in a while. Oh yeah, I had to redo the doors stuff as well to get the keys to work like I wanted, because before they actually ate your key. So if you open a door with a yellow key, the key would be disappear. Which I liked in a way, but not really a good fit for my purposes, I think. Maybe I should make a different version of a door, key door. So I'm gonna have key cards like you've seen, but also ethereal keys for the more the map in Duel 9 that I showed with the red textures and fire and brimstone stuff. And maybe they would be more one use keys, so we'll see. Reminding me of the skull keys in Doom 2016, where you basically push it into a socket and leave it there. Maybe something like that. So this is the first map I showed, which is called the Shaft, which I'm working on presently to make into what I want it to be. But I realized that my ability as a level designer isn't as strong as I feel like it might have used to be, or maybe I just realized that other players in the scene has actually surpassed me in skill, because I haven't had time to work on it and developing myself while they have been developing myself. So I talked to some people the other day and asked them if they would be interested in helping out with maps and maybe get some properly good maps by people who actually are focused and invested in making the best maps they can do. So we'll see what happens there, and also asked around for some programming help to make the enemies better, because that's an area that I'm struggling with. Also maybe getting someone to do these videos, because I realize I'm not as strong, I'm not really good at speaking into a microphone like this, because my voice just tends to go really low and really tired sounding. Maybe I should just get a couple of beers in me before I start next time. Anyway, I've been going on with this for about 45 minutes now, and I think that finishing the game as a whole would be better without single player. Well, the point of the multiplayer aspect was basically to get the basics plotted down, which I feel like I was getting in that ballpark, at least, with the last update. I mean, there were still things to work on, like animations of weapons and stuff like that, but the basic game was there. Now it was just a matter of making more maps, more things. But the end goal was always really to do the single player aspect, because there are so really quite a lot of arena FPS games in the multiplayer aspect. Ever since Quake 3 Arena, people have made their own versions of that, and Unreal Tournament as well. And when I started, I really felt there was a dearth of single player games in this area. It was really only Doom and Duke Nukem that I felt, and Blood and those old 90s games. But that has changed a lot since then, of course. I mean, we first had Doom 2016, that, while it was not quite what I was looking for myself, it was still a very solid single-player game experience where you had a lot of the same ideas that went into the old Doom games, for instance, where the faster movement, even though it wasn't that fast, but was still a fun game to play. And then, of course, more recently with Dusk, even though it was quite janky, I felt, the whole collision thing where you could climb on walls that were very, very aggressively sloped, didn't feel very good to me. But the game really got strong in the and later parts, I felt, and gave me a lot of fun action to do. So it's nice to see that there are other games coming out, like I think Amid Evil might be one of them as well. I haven't tried it yet, but if anyone, it looks like it's for people who liked Heretic and Hexen. So yeah, from the beginning it was only meant to be single player, really, but because the first engine I started working on it with, it didn't even have multiplayer, but I had to move away from it because I couldn't actually work and do the things I wanted with that engine. It was a bit it was a rack engine. Sorry for saying an ohm so much. Jesus. So yeah, I've been meaning to move into single player for a long time, but there was always something more I wanted to do with multiplayer first. And at the end, while I'm still working on multiplayer, basically to, I mean, some of the things do, a lot of the things do overlap, like weapons and stuff. I think the basics of the, like the TDM and the single dual modes are as solid as they are going to be. But without actually having proper net client prediction and stuff like that, which I've been working on adding in, but I'm still far off understanding all the intricacies of that stuff. There's really no reason to keep restricting myself to the multiplayer aspect and just keep working on realizing the vision I had for the game from the beginning. Like all the enemies I make, they can be used as player models for the multiplayer. The power-ups, they can be used for making interesting maps for multiplayer. The barrels and stuff like that, the textures. So a lot of it does has relevance to both areas. But the things that hasn't doesn't have relevance is like the saving system, like in the menus and stuff, and some of the UI elements. But that's not really the things that take the most time. It just most it takes a lot of it takes a bit of elbow grease, I guess it would be a word for it, to just sit down and do it. It's not terribly difficult, it's just kind of boring stuff. Oh yeah, how could I forget? I've been working on something specifically for multiplayer as well, Jason. I've been wanting to make the spectator abilities improved in multiplayer, and the things I've done for that case. Oh. Is I've made I made the heads-up display for spectating a bit more detailed. Still working on it because I wanted to make it look a bit more fancy, which meant that I want. So if you look up beneath Wallis, you won't see any of those. Okay, this is another thing that I'm had to fix because with the new updated engine, I had to redo a lot of these elements because. Okay, so you see, you will see a difference between the health bar between Nomad and Wally here. Jeez, why is it running so badly? Anyway. Okay, so yeah, I'm working on this to make it render properly. But you have things like what weapon they are got up, and if they are alive or dead, and then health bars. Eventually I'll add power-up indicators as well and stuff like that. So yeah, you see it's a bit of a mess so far. And I have a bug here with a weapon where it somehow gets confused of what weapon is out. And draws a blank, a texture that doesn't exist. So that's a bit of the things that's happening for the single for the multiplayer aspect. I don't understand why is everything running so slow right now. Oh well. Yeah, Nick, I do have a Discord. If you go to doombringer.eu, you can just go and click for, let's see here. If you go here, you have a Discord, Reddit, a public Trello. I need to update some of these things, so a little bit of a frequently asked questions, all the files, about, and a change log for the most recently released version. Also have a I need to add the link to my to our in the DB site, which has a bit more information on it. I'm doing some updates there, for instance. So for instance, here are some of the new models that are coming to be in the game. I'm still haven't done the detail pass on these, so that's why I haven't put them in yet. This one is a bit further off from being complete. This one needs a detail pass as well. This one, etc. Yep. I think I might have remembered to everything I wanted to talk about now. Hopefully. I was hoping I would do this a bit better, but I am no too good. After all, I should, which I already knew I wasn't, so. Yeah. I'll be trying to do some more streams where I work on things in the future. I'm not sure if that will be something people will like to watch, but I think it might help me when I work on maps, for instance, because if I articulate what I'm planning with a map and stuff like that, I might be able to get past some of the roadblocks I'm encountering when I map, because sometimes you just end up spending an hour circling a map and not getting anything done. Like this, fiddling with some stuff or endlessly roaming hallways which you feel you haven't done nearly enough work on yet. Anyway, like I said, I'll plan to keep working on this multiplayer. It's not something I'm aborting, but a greater focus on my efforts will go towards single player, because I think that is where Doombringer will have the possibility of being standing out amongst the crowd. Not just in arena FPS community, but in general. But time will tell, and if anyone has any suggestions for ideas that they think I should entertain, then by all means go ahead and flaunt them on Discord or Reddit or wherever you may prefer. And some people, I've had a comment about a month ago about adding more weapons. I do have more weapons planned, but not a lot more weapons, because I think a lot of games do this where they add a boatload of weapons, and then when you play it just becomes a mess getting to the weapon that you actually want to have. So instead, I'd rather have few weapons that are specialized for special reasons, like the railgun, which is basically the basic setup that I think works really well for a game like this. And then, if I have a really good idea for a weapon, or if I'm suggested a really good idea for a weapon, I'd definitely consider adding that. I have been suggested a few ideas that I been thinking about adding. A Power Fist by Crazy Al, for instance, and shit like that. I just noticed GNT asked if we should do a King of the Hill tomorrow, and I think that might be a good idea. So I'm floating that idea here, right here, right now. Not sure about time right now, but I'll announce something on the Discord when I know more what time works for everyone else. So just write in the Discord if you have any reason to miss out, if it's not the perfect time for you. Yeah, I think that'll be enough for now. Thank you for listening to my droning voice. Yeah, mouse controlled rockers lacking Sonotic. Yeah, actually, I think Half-Life was should be credited for thinking of that one first. But yeah, they do have that. I've always wondered what the tuba does in Sonotic. Anyway, thanks for listening, like I said, and see you hopefully tomorrow. Thank you. Mm-hmm.